my opinion, heavy bound and hand fighting is probably the single best way to control the pace of the match and to control whether the match happens standing or seated. So I'm starting you guys off with a drill that I use just about every day to ready to practice and ready for matches, just to get me firing off and moving well. Similar to when boxers, right, are you guys got the concept of here and dragging it off, right? What I want to do is, when I have it inside of the ground, placing his hands on the mat, and here I lift it up and get back to the position. Right on the mat. To the tie, this is the right on the mat. Okay, once you're good. This is considered winning. If your opponent has inside bicep tie, inside collar tie, he's winning the hand fight right now. Now you're gonna do your collar tie, and I'm back on. He gets back to the collar tie. Overtime drag. You're going about 10 to 20% back and forth. So instead of like I go, you go, we're constantly fighting. Like treat it like a live, only 10 to 20% of your capability, right? Make it a more fluid motion where you guys are earning the inside collar tie. There's some tension here and some realism to the movements, okay? 1, 2, 3. Collar tie, he pulls to my rear shoulder. As he pulls, I bump the elbow and I step in. Knee goes to the ground right in front of my opponent's foot. My rear leg comes up. And all I do is take it back. And then I'm down, right to my opponent's back. Okay, 1, 2, 3. My opponent's back in a dominant position. I always want to start, instead of having this grip on the center line, this is very common, people try to dominate from here, and it just never works as well as forcing a long arm, short arm, body about high to his grips, and I transfer my weight. So I lean my weight over one shoulder, placing my opponent's hands on the mat. You can always get going. He's a good guy, I'm gonna get tops here. That's why I got me better than him. Any other questions? 1, 2, 3. Eventually, fighting. I do the down stepping ground. Now I want to give it to the mat. I start extending my leg behind his knee and start circling with my rear leg. Circle. We end up in a dominant position. So I get my partner's back. Boom, right here, we're I step in front. I extend my leg behind my opponent's kneecap, lean my weight forward, and I start pushing away. And I end up in a dominant back take. Push away. And we end up in a dominant back take. Now to break my opponent down, I simply open my right knee, redirecting the angle of his knee line, dropping him down to the mat. I open my right knee, changing the angle of his knee. One, two, three.
That felt actually nice.
I go angle to angle, right foot goes angle to angle, I pick up and I move his foot. As I change the angle of his foot, I immediately go far trap, far hip. Step back and tap. One, two, three, three. This is much better. Going over the post. So once again, partner, tripods. One, two, three. He faces me. Immediately, I dive in and secure my body lock. Now, my body lock consists of 2 pounds. We try to apply my body lock. So, 1, 2, 3. I dive in for my body lock. Now, I have my hands locked. I go along my shoulder on grip. Head still in the center line. I'm moving towards my grip. And I force heel to butt connection on your core. As he sits up, boom, I dive in immediately for the body lock. Now it's time for me to dive in. Long arm, short arm, head on the center line. By sprawling, one hip down. As I sprawl, I walk to one side, eliminating one hook. 2, 3, 4, 5. Few choppy steps. I place pin to the mat, trying to sit up. It's much more difficult for him because I'm weighted on his shoulders. Now, I can complete the pass by raising my hips, turning my left knee in to guide his defensive leg through. 1, 2, 3.
Electricity most of the time,
and we just have fun a lot of
right. I heard Don Hunter say that the quickest way to progress is to start learning to wrestle with your legs. What are some techniques or things that we should do to improve that?
I think learning to wrestle with your legs in the sense of late defense, like, because if you're not worried about getting something, you know, via heel hook, which is a big hole in, you know, the everyday visual jiu-jitsu, like most people just don't train them and they neglect that part of the game. Being proficient in defensive leg locks really allows you to open up your game and allows you to start attacking various options. In addition to that, being able to leg block somebody can get you out of a lot of tough situations, especially against bigger guys. You know, you're able to maneuver the weight and get to the weakest point in the body, which is kind of, you know, weakest point in the body, I mean, like, putting your whole body against one leg makes that leg the weakest point of the body.
How do you balance flexibility with lifting and whatnot? Obviously, you're fairly flexible. Is it more of a natural thing for you?
I was always pretty athletic. You know, I wrestled for a long time, like since I was like 12 or so. And I think throughout wrestling really helped me become an athlete, because it forced us to do athletic things. It forced us to learn how to do cartwheels, learn how to do backflips. We do a lot of stuff with splits and handstands and jumping rope and a lot of dynamic athletic movements to go on in the wrestling room, and really transition over to other sports as well.
Because I'm assuming you're lifting like once or twice, or maybe four times out of the week, and then training like twice a day.
So my schedule is I lift once a day, and I train jiu-jitsu once a day, so 7 days a week, right? There's a common myth of that you can overtrain. I think most people don't even know how to overtrain. They don't know what overtraining is. You know what I mean? Like most people just like, you know, stop when they're tired. There's nothing wrong with that. There's not everybody's meant to do like extreme stuff. You know what I mean? But this is common. I hear this all the time. Like, oh, I don't want to overtrain. Most people don't have the drive or the willpower to overtrain. So if you think you're overtraining, I guarantee you're not. Can you take another step after practice? You know, can you walk to your car after your lift? You're alive. You're not overtraining. You know what I mean? So don't be afraid to push harder. You know, harder to gym, harder to practice. Like it's too exhaustion. Just like kind of, you know, like for me, like I lift every day because first and foremost because I love it. I enjoy it. You know what I mean? Something I look forward to doing every day. Secondary, I think it's a great way. I consider muscle your body's armor. You know, the more muscle you have, I think the better you can take a hit, the better you can recover, the more dense you are, you know, so that holds some value in the weight itself. And I think lifting is just a good way to stay healthy. So I wouldn't worry about overtraining, because I really don't think there's a such thing as overtraining. You know, I lift every day, I do jiu-jitsu every day, I've been doing it 7 days a week for like 3 years now. I've been lifting every day for like 7 years, but you know, jiu-jitsu and lifting for like 3 years, and you know, I've never felt better. I feel strong. You know, I even feel like when I feel run down, you know, and tired, if I do lift, the next day I'll feel better.
Do you recommend doing the weightlifting like before the jiu-jitsu training, in the sense of, you know?
Good question. I always lift after training because my first workout is always the most important. It's going to be most strenuous, most intense. And weightlifting is going to be secondary to jiu-jitsu. But lifting doesn't pay my bills, it just helps me feel good and look good. So I make sure I lift, you know, heavily after a training session. And I mean, it's just my routine. Like I don't think about my day without, you know, jiu-jitsu and wrestling. So jiu-jitsu and weightlifting, every kind of like, you know, focus is focused around that. Yes.
What's your nutrition look like, and how do you balance it with your knees?
thank you. So my nutrition is usually, I eat mainly meats, fruits, vegetables, pretty simple. I like to keep it, you know, like, not to say I don't eat processed food, but I, like, if I had the choice of, like, fucking, you know, like, a meatball sandwich or a steak, I'd probably take a steak, you know what I mean, things like that. But generally, I just do meats, fruits, vegetables, and I make sure I eat every day my body weight in protein. So I make sure the bare minimum, you know, if I'm 240 pounds, I give it 240 grams. That's like the minimum that I would like. I do my best to never go below that. Now, if I'm home and I'm on regimen, typically it's like 350 to 400 grams a day. And that consists of, usually it's like 300 grams of food and then the extra 50 grams or 100 grams of like protein shake or shake, stuff like that. So yeah, it's a lot of food. It's part of the job. And it's not always easy to eat that much food, you know, like a lot of times, probably more times than not, I'm up at 2 a.m. just, you know, pounding food. It's part of the job. And I make it a point, I made a staple in my life to say, like, listen, I'm not going to go to sleep until I do this, until I eat enough, until I eat this, I hit this number, you know what I mean? I think that has a great benefit in your long-term success and the development of your body. Like, if you're a young guy, you know, you got to make sure you're eating enough to replenish and to repair the body. Like, a lot of people get injured, you know, and I think a good way to prevent injury or to get better through injury, along with proper rehab, is you got to make sure you're eating. I know guys really miss out on that part.
Are you counting macros outside of protein?
No, I just count the protein, mainly because it's just too much work. Like, I'd much rather just, I go like carbs and stuff like based on how I feel.
Yeah.
So generally before practice, you know, I have you know, a bunch of fruit and maybe a protein shake or something. I'm pretty lazy in the morning. So protein shake and a couple oranges suffice. And then after practice, fruit immediately, and I start really eating, you know, get into the meats and stuff like that. But generally just fruits, a little bit of vegetables in there, but fruits and meats mainly. Yeah.
Same thing when you're traveling, because I travel shit tons of work and I know it's a lot harder to...
Yeah, I mean, the thing is with us, like, I just have to eat so much food. Like, bro, like, if you hung out with me for a day, you'd understand. Like, it's like, you know, wherever we go, we eat 4 or 5 times a day. I have to get 2 meals every time we go to eat.
Yeah.
So, you know, it takes a little bit longer, it's just more time investment. And then, like, fucking eating when you don't eat, like, it's kind of, like, it's fine. Like, I like it, you know, I'm not complaining at all. But, that's part of the job.
Yeah, if you're eating, that's like, you're eating at least 1,500 calories of protein.
Probably,
so, like,
yeah.
4,000 at least calories
of water. Yeah, yeah, it's quite a bit of food, yeah.
Train like that, do you train specifically for the event you're going for, or do you guys have, like, a certain, like what's your standard of rounds?
So,
how long of a practice?
So, our practice usually consists of an hour, sometimes being 2 hours of learning, drilling itself. Then we do about 45 minutes to an hour of live afterwards. And the rounds consist of, right, like, if we do 45 to an hour of live, like, John doesn't have, like, a clock. He just kind of just goes, and whenever he feels like stopping, he stops it. So I think that variable of not knowing how long you're going to go enables you to pace yourself a lot better. I think it's a good idea to have a clock. Like, for instance, we've been doing, after our practices, right, after the rolling from live for 45 minutes or an hour, we've been doing 15-minute matches after. So because who's number one has specific rules of 15-minute sub only, we've been doing a lot of scramble wrestling and sub only matches at the end of practice. So we make sure we get all of our drilling technical stuff to work in. We do the 45 to an hour of live. And typically that kind of live is structured as positional training. So like first round, have a guy mounting on top of you, he goes to sub or to escape. Second round, turtle. Third round, you know, we go ashigarami, 50-50. And then maybe we do full guard and then standing. We're standing a couple of levels through there. So a lot of positional training, putting yourself in bad positions makes that competition much easier. I think it's good. I think a lot of people neglect being in bad positions because they don't like being on their back. They don't like having somebody on their back or having somebody, letting somebody get an arm bar them. I think letting, especially lower belts, if I'm rolling with a blue belt, I'll let him extend my arm, let him put me in a full triangle, you know, and doing things like that. Really boosts your confidence when defending. Late defense is a big thing. A lot of guys, even the pros, some of the pros you see, they get to, you know, you get a choke on them, they tap immediately because they just, they either quit or they just actually don't know how to escape because they're never in that position. So you constantly put yourself in bad positions. You know, you come at home, you know, comfortable. And ultimately, that's the best thing for competition.